Hey, welcome everyone. Today's lecture is on chemical bonding, and we're going to start with electronegativity. Now, when you have a covalent bond that is established between two atoms and they share an electron pair, that electron pair is not always equally shared. That electron pair, more often than not, is shared unequally. One of the atoms that is sharing it has a stronger pull on electrons than the other. That strength with which atoms pull on electrons is called electronegativity. Now, when we have a molecule that has two of the same atoms, of course, they have the same electronegativity, so they are going to share the electron pair equally. And we can call that 100% ionic bond, or covalent bond, sorry. So, but in most instances, the bonds are formed between different atoms, and you can see the way that the electron pair is being shared by looking at an electrostatic potential map where the electron densities are shown by different colors. And we call that type of bond where the electrons are not being shared equally a polar covalent bond. Where the electrons spend more time is negative because of the charge on electrons. Where they spend less time is going to be positive. So for instance, in a hydrogen fluoride molecule, the electron pair being shared will spend more time around the fluorine. Fluorine has a higher electronegativity than hydrogen. And we say that the bond is polar because the electrons spend more time around the more electronegative atom. And we also, if we have a molecule that is a certain shape, in this case, it's linear with two atoms, then we can say that the molecule itself is polar. And we'll talk more about that in future lectures. So now the electron density always shifts toward the more electronegative atom. On your periodic table, you actually have lists of electronegativities. So if I can just show you that. Here we have a periodic table here. The number on this periodic table in the top right-hand corner for fluorine, the number is 3.98. You can see it's located for almost all the atoms except for the atoms that don't form chemical bonds. So you don't have to memorize electronegativities. You're allowed to use this periodic table, and you're simply going to use those numbers to solve problems that we're going to cover in a few slides. So the electronegativity really is a measure of the atom's ability to compete for the electrons that it's sharing within the bond. The atom that is more electronegative will gain electrons more so than the atom that is less electronegative. This is related to both the ionization energy and the electron affinity. And to review, the ionization energy is the amount of energy it takes to remove an electron from an atom. And the electron affinity is the amount of energy released when an atom gains an electron. You can think of a bond as being like an elastic band. As it gets stretched, you're storing energy. And that's what happens when you're removing electrons from atoms. And then when you let the elastic band go, that is similar to what happens when the electrons travel towards the nucleus of an atom. Some of their energy is in fact released. And we call that electron affinity. So the ionization energy is the quantity of energy in a gaseous atom that is absorbed to be able to expel an electron. So again, like that elastic band, it takes energy to stretch that elastic band. It takes energy to remove electrons from atoms. And the more electronegative an atom is, the more energy required to remove the electron. So when we look at this case, if we have a magnesium atom, the ionization energy here can be quantified as 738 kilojoules per mole. It's the amount of energy required to remove an electron from a magnesium atom, one electron. Of course, to remove the next electron would require a little more energy because it would be a little closer to the nucleus. And since magnesium has two electrons in its outer shell, the third ionization energy would take a bit of a jump, because now we're starting to get electrons from the inside shells of the atom, and that requires even more energy. So the electron affinity, if you may, is the negative value of the energy change that occurs when a gaseous atom gains an electron. So again, the elastic band is being released as the electron moves closer, energy is being released. So when atoms gain electrons, they release that energy. So an example, we can qualify that as well. When a fluorine atom gains an electron to form a fluoride ion, notice that the energy is negative. Okay, so electron affinity, thought of as the energy must be supplied to remove an electron from an anion. So in this case, it's positive. So why are the electron affinities for inert gases negative? Well, that's because inert gases or noble gases have their outer shells completely filled and they're very stable. They don't require any more electrons. If you force inert gases to accept electron energy, the EA is in fact the energy electron affinity is a negative value. So this quantity, the added together for the ionization energy and electron affinity provides a measure of the ability of how strongly atoms pull on electron pairs. So we call that quantity the electronegativity of an atom in a bond. And an element with a high ionization energy and a large negative electron affinity, like fluorine, will have a high electronegativity value relative to an atom with a low ionization energy and a low electron affinity. So Linus Pauling was one of the first people to actually quantify these in experimentation. And he created an electronegativity scale that ranges from 0.7 to 4.0. Again, I showed you where it is on the periodic table. You're not required to memorize these numbers, but simply apply them. So on the periodic table, the least electronegative element is 0.70, and it's down here. And the most electronegative element is up here. It's fluorine. And of course, these numbers simply show you the relative strength with which an atom pulls on an electron. So the polarity of a chemical bond can be determined by looking at the electronegativities of the atoms involved in that covalent bond. So if they have a difference in electronegativity that's greater than or equal to 2.0, we can call it an ionic bond. There's almost a complete charge transfer, so the electron is basically being transferred from the less electronegative element to the more electronegative element. And we describe the bond as having a high percentage ionic character. And I'll show you how to quantify that in a few slides. Now, if the difference in electronegativity is less than 0.4, then we can describe it as a covalent bond with almost no transfer and a low ionic character, percent ionic character. Now, if it's somewhere in between a difference of electronegativity of 0.4 to 2, we call that a polar covalent bond, which is a partial transfer of charge. And here is a graph showing different types of binary compounds. And you can see, for instance, metals and nonmetals tend to form ionic bonds with high percentage ionic characters. Two nonmetals tend to form bonds that have low percentage ionic characters that are more covalent in nature. These ones are ionic in nature, but it is a continuum and there's no one model that we can use to describe bonding that is perfect. At times we'll use different models to describe bonding to fit the observational science that goes along with it. So I'm going to show you an example of percentage ionic character problems that you're going to be required to solve on your test next Tuesday. A week from today, we're going to have our second test. So the question could take a form like this, saying, describe the bonding which exists between chlorine and silicon. So what you're going to do is look up on your periodic table the electronegativities of chlorine and silicon. And to do this, you're going to see here is chlorine. It's got an electronegativity of 3.16. And silicon is here. It's got an electronegativity of 1.90. And you'll notice there is a chart up here as well that shows you the relationship between the difference in electronegativity and the percent ionic character of the bond. So I'll show you how to use that in a minute. So we look up at, like I said, chlorine is 3.16. That's the strength with which chlorine atoms pull on electrons. We have silicon, 1.90. And when we find the difference in electronegativity, we simply subtract those two values. And you get a value of 1.26 for a difference in electronegativity. Now, we're going to use that percentage ionic character table on your periodic table that I just showed you. So what you're going to notice is 1.26 is not in that table, because that table that we've just looked at, 1.26 is going to be between 1.2 and 1.3. So it's somewhere between 30 and 34%. So I'm going to show you how you can kind of zoom in on exactly what the value of the percent ionic character will be based on this difference in electronegativity. So let's take a look, shall we, how we do that. So obviously 1.26 is in between 1.2 and 1.3. So typically when we interpolate between two values, we divide it into 10 equal parts, the decimal system, of course. And if we take the percent ionic character, it goes from 30% to 34%. So we could also divide it into 10 equal parts. So the difference between 30% and 34% is 4%. A tenth of 4% is 0.4%. So each spot on this table would be up by 0.4%. So we can then say, well, if a difference in electronegativity 1.20 is 30%, a difference of 1.21 would be 30.4%. 1.22 would be 30.80%. And you can see the pattern that goes right across the table. So when we look at the difference as 1.26, we can see the percent ionic character would be 32.4% ionic character. And in this case, the significant digit would just be to the nearest decimal place. So what is that telling us? It's telling us that the bond is a polar covalent bond. It's telling us that the electron pair will migrate toward the more electronegative element, creating a density cloud that has more electron, it's more electron dense near the more electronegative element. Okay, we can see on that scale, again, it's between 0.4 and 0.2. So the bond between those two atoms is a polar covalent bond. When they share an electron pair, the electron pair spends more time closer to the chlorine because it's more electronegative. It makes the chlorine end of that bond negative, and it makes the silicon end of that bond positive. So if I was going to create a little picture, I could simply show it like this, where I show the electron pair shading a little bit towards the more electronegative element. Now, let's try a second one here just to go over it one more time. Let's talk about the bond that would form between bromine and phosphorus when they share an electron pair. So again, we look up in the periodic table, bromine and phosphorus. So bromine is here. It's got an electronegativity of 2.96. Phosphorus is here. It's got an electronegativity of 2.19. So that would be the first thing we would do. Now we're going to take the difference between the two of them. And when we subtract, we get 0.77 as a difference in electronegativity. And again, we look at this chart, 0.77 is not on this chart, but 0.77 will be between 0.7 and 0.8, somewhere between 13 and 15%. So let's again do a little bit of an interpolation here. So we know 0.77 is going to be here in the scale between 0.7 and 0.8. Now, when we divide percent ionic character scale, it only goes from 12% to 15%. That's 3%. So if we divide into 10 equal parts, 3% divided into 10 equal parts is going to be 0.3. And 0.3 times 7 is 0.21. So it's, we can add that to the 12%, 2.1, and we get 14.1% is kind of the quick way of doing it. There we are. So again, we look and we see that this is a polar covalent bond because it is in that range for the difference in electronegativity. And there are the differences in percent ionic character that tell us whether it's covalent or polar covalent or ionic. Now, the bond between the phosphorus and the bromine is polar covalent, which means it spends more time toward the bromine and less around the phosphorus. So the bromine end will be negative and the phosphorus end will be positive. And again, we can simply show it as being shaded like this. You draw an electron pair in between the two and showing the percent ionic character is 14.1. Okay, so I'm going to ask you to solve these questions in the PowerPoint presentation. If you can download it from OnQ, there's no need for me to go over these again. I'm just going to skip ahead and we can take them up at another time. And also sample problems. I'd like you to try and figure out the percent ionic character of the bonds formed between these pairs of atoms for practice. And the answers are in the PowerPoint presentation. And you can look them up after you practice them yourself. Now what I'm going to do is shift to the next topic in our continuum. So right now we're going to talk about formal charges and oxidation numbers as tools to understand bonding. Now there's several ways we can account for electrons when we draw Lewis structures. We can either show Lewis structures as being sharing electron pairs, or we can show Lewis structures where the electron pairs actually get transferred completely to the more electronegative element from the less electronegative element in a classic ionic bonding situation, which we talked about in the previous lecture. So in the case of a bond formed between two atoms of chlorine, because each chlorine atom has the same electronegativity, we would say that that bond is equally shared. It would be a covalent bond. Now, most compounds lie somewhere in between a covalent and an ionic bond. And for those particular types of bonds, we are going to assume that it's either 100% ionic or 100% covalent for bookkeeping purposes, dependent on the situation. So if we assume the bond is 100% ionic, which means there's a significant difference in electronegativity, we can calculate what's called an oxidation number for each element. And you've been doing that when you've been figuring out the formulas for various compounds. You're simply assigning the electron pair completely to the more electronegative atom. Well, there's a second way we can assign numbers for bonding purposes, and that's if we assume that the bond is 100% covalent. In that case, we're going to calculate what we call formal charges for each element to keep track of those electrons. In a formal charge, we're going to assume the electron pairs are being shared equally. So in a pair of electrons that's being shared equally, we're going to transfer one of the charges from the electron to the more electronegative element, and one electron to the less electronegative element. We're going to share them completely. And we use that as a tool to determine whether or not various Lewis structures are practical or not, whether they are likely to exist or not. And I'm going to show you that in some examples here. Now, I just talked about this already. So example here, oxidation number, if it's a metal and a non-metal, usually what happens, there's a complete transfer of charge. So the chlorine atom becomes a chloride ion. The sodium atom becomes a sodium ion. And its oxidation number for sodium would be +1. And the oxidation number for the chloride would be -1. If we assumed a complete transfer of electron pairs. Now, in that case, if we did figure out the percent ionic character of the bond, it would be greater than 70%. It's around 70%. The difference in electronegativity is 2.2. Chlorine is definitely more electronegative, likely an ionic bond here. Now, in a formal charge, we're going to assume, as I've said before, that the electrons are being equally shared. And again, this is just a tool that we use to determine whether a Lewis structure is likely when we draw one. So when we're assigning formal charges, we're going to assume all the bonds are 100% covalent and the electrons are equally shared between the bonding atoms. So if I have a molecule of hydrogen chloride, we're going to assume this bond is going to be equally shared for the purposes of establishing what we call a formal charge. So in this case, even though chlorine is more electronegative than hydrogen, we know the electron pair is going to shade toward the chlorine. However, when I'm assigning formal charges, I am not going to consider the more electronegative element. I'm simply going to look at the two of them and say, well, chlorine has 7 electrons in its outer shell. Hydrogen has 1. So if I'm assigning a formal charge to chlorine, I'm going to start with the number of electrons chlorine normally shares, which are 7. And then from that, I'm going to assume that these electron pairs, which are not being shared, belong completely to the chlorine. Now, this pair of electrons is being shared between the hydrogen and the chlorine. One of the electrons is going to be assigned to the chlorine, and the other electron is going to be assigned to the hydrogen. So to assign a formal charge, basically, we're going to consider this model, and we are going to say, well, if chlorine started with 7 electrons, and in this model, we still have 7 electrons accounted for, we're going to say it has a formal charge of 0. Hydrogen, it started with 1 electron that it involved in bonding, and it only shared 1 electron pair. So the 1 electron from hydrogen that's being shared with the chlorine will also be taken into account to establish the formal charge. So the formal charge of the hydrogen will be also 0. So now, a more mathematical, if you're a person that likes to use simple mathematical equations to assign the formal charge, you can take the number of valence electrons in the free atom, like I said, for chlorine was 7, and you're gonna subtract all the non-bonded electrons, which in this case were 6, and then you're gonna select half of the bonded electrons, which is 1. So 7 take away 6 take away 1 is equal to 0. And that's the formula you could use. But I just like to use common sense. And again, the common sense says electrons that aren't being shared are going to belong to that atom. Electrons that are being shared, one of the electrons are going to be evenly divided between the two atoms. And as I said, for hydrogen, has 1 valence shell electron. And since it's sharing, there's 2 being shared here. One of them is going to be assigned to the hydrogen. So its formal charge will be 1 take away 1, which is 0. For the chlorine, it was 7 take away 6 take away half of 2, which is 1, which is 0. Okay. So now let's apply the same principle here to this particular Lewis structure. So this chlorine has... it has 7 valence shell electrons to figure out its formal charge. None of these electrons are being shared. So they're going to belong totally to the chlorine. This bond, however, which is 2 electrons, a stick always represents 2 electrons, one of them belongs to the chlorine. So the formal charge on chlorine here again would be 7 take away 7, 0. Now we're going to apply the formal charge to nitrogen. Nitrogen has 5 electrons that it typically uses in bonding. It's sharing an electron pair here and here, and it has an unshared pair here. So of the 5 electrons that nitrogen put into this bonding arrangement, we would subtract 2, and 1 and 1 is 2, we would subtract 4. So 5 take away 4 is 1. The formal charge on nitrogen here would be 1. And for oxygen here, the formal charge would be, well, oxygen contributes 6 electrons. These 6 electrons belong completely to this oxygen. And one of those electrons that's being shared with the nitrogen also belongs to this oxygen. So if I'm applying a formal charge for this oxygen, it's going to be a -1. All right. And that, just to summarize what I've said, here are the numbers. The formal charge on nitrogen, I said, was 1. The formal charge on oxygen was -1. And the formal charge on chlorine was 0. Now that means there's probably a Lewis, if we can find a Lewis structure where all of these are going to be zero, that would be a better representation of what actually happens in a molecule that contains one atom of nitrogen, one atom of oxygen, one atom of chlorine. And I'll get into that a little bit later. But for now, all I'm showing you how to do is how to figure out formal charges on each atom in a Lewis structure and use it as a tool to decide whether the Lewis structure is possible. In this case, like I said, we could probably come up with a Lewis structure that would be better than this one. Now, let's take a look again. Here is ammonium ion. It's got a charge of positive one. If I'm applying a formal charge to nitrogen, I would say, well, nitrogen has five valence shell electrons. And in this case, there's a pair here, a pair here, a pair here, and a pair here. One of those from the pair belongs to nitrogen. So nitrogen started with five, and if we take away four, we end up with a formal charge of nitrogen of one. And on the diagram, we can actually show the formal charge with a plus sign beside the element where we've assigned the charge, plus one or just plus. Now for hydrogen, hydrogen has one valence shell electron and it's sharing one pair of electrons here. One of the electrons from that pair is going to belong to hydrogen. So the hydrogens on each of these locations will be zeros. No need to show formal charges of zeros. So it's a plus one here for nitrogen. The overall charge of this ion, ammonium, is one plus. So we have to have a formal charge of one plus somewhere. So in all likelihood, this is the proper Lewis structure for ammonium. All right, so I've explained that, put it in words. And now let's take a look at another example. Here we have hydroxide ion. Overall charge is minus one. Let's figure out the formal charges. So for oxygen here, oxygen, well, these electron pairs are not being shared between oxygen and any other atom. So they must belong to the oxygen. So oxygen has six valence shell electrons. It's going to have six electrons that are unshared here, and it's going to have one of the pair that is being shared between oxygen and hydrogen. So that means there's a total of seven electrons that belong to oxygen in this bookkeeping method. So six take away seven is minus one. So the formal charge on oxygen is minus one. For hydrogen, again, hydrogen only has one valence shell electron and it gets one from this pair. So its formal charge will be zero. Hydroxide ion has an overall charge of minus one. The formal charge on oxygen has to be minus one. When we add them up, it adds up to the same charge as the charge on the ion. And that's how we assign formal charges to atoms, again, in a Lewis structure. Now, again, it's very helpful when you're using Lewis structures to identify the best possible Lewis structure, because sometimes we can transfer electrons from unshared pairs to shared pairs in order to make formal charges lower. So typically, we want formal charges should be as small as possible. Real molecules are not very stable if you have high localized charges. So rule number two, or rule B, the negative formal charge has to be on the more electronegative atom. In the case of the previous examples, oxygen was more electronegative than hydrogen. So that made sense when it had a formal charge of minus one. And rule C, a structure with a formal charge of more than plus or minus one on any of the atoms is usually an incorrect structure. So you're going to modify your Lewis structure to get rid of that charge that's greater than plus or minus one. And the last rule, if structures having formal charges of the same sign are on atoms that are beside each other, it's usually unlikely, unless it's for an ion that has a charge, like phosphate, for instance, with a minus three charge. It's certainly possible there to have adjacent atoms with more than one negative charge. But if it's a neutral molecule, you can't have adjacent atoms with two negative formal charges. You've made a mistake. You have to go back to the drawing board and draw another Lewis structure. So let's look at an example here. Here we have a sulfate ion with a negative 2 charge. So in this case, we could assign the formal charge to sulfur. Remember, sulfur has 6 electrons that it involves in bonding. So in this case, there's double bonds in all 4 locations. Sulfur having 6 valence shell electrons, we can see that these 2 pairs of electrons being shared result in 4 electrons. The sulfur is going to belong to 2 of those. So there's 2 electrons that the sulfur gets from this double bond, this double bond, this double bond, and this double bond. That amounts to 8 electrons total. Well, if sulfur only has 6 electrons that it shares and it has 8, then we can say the sulfur atom has a -2 charge. Now for oxygen, let's look at the formal charges. For oxygen, oxygen has 6 valence shell electrons. This represents unshared pairs. They have to belong to the oxygen in this bookkeeping system. So 6, take away 4 is 2. And then if we get 1 from each of these pairs of electrons belonging to oxygen, we get 0. Similarly, 0, 0, 0. So this Lewis structure looks to be probably not correct, because we could probably do a better job of lowering the formal charge on the sulfur. Now, we'll look at other possibilities, okay? So as I've said, formal charges on the oxygens in this arrangement are all zeros. Sulfur has a formal charge of -2. The sum of the formal charges adds up to -2. But can we distribute that formal charge? In other words, can we have 2 atoms that will have -1 formal charges? And that would probably be a better arrangement for a sulfate ion. So here we have another example. We have 4 single bonds between sulfur and oxygen, accounting for sulfate. And when we do that again, since sulfur has 6 electrons, and 1 of the electrons in each of these bonds belongs to sulfur, so that's only accounting for 4 electrons belonging to sulfur. It had 6. 6 take away 4 is +2. The formal charge on sulfur would be +2. Now for oxygen, it has 6 valence shell electrons involved in bonding. So if we subtract these unshared pairs, 6 take away 6 is 0. And 1 of these electrons in this bonded pair, it belongs to oxygen, that's going to be in -1. So each oxygen in this model would be -1. Well, again, the formal charges, in this case, if we add 4 minus to 2 plus, we get a 2 minus charge. Probably unlikely because of the +2 charge of sulfur. So there's our second trial where we assign those formal charges and we've decided probably not the right answer. So now let's go to a third trial. Let's mix it up a bit. So in this case, we're going to make 2 double bonds and 2 single bonds. And when we apply the formal charge rules again, oxygen is 6, 2, 4, 6, those all belong to oxygen. 1 of those belongs to oxygen, so it's going to be a -1. Where there's a single bond, it will be a -1. Here's a single bond, that's a -1. Now, where there's a double bond, oxygen has 6 electrons. We're going to take those 4, belong to this oxygen atom. So 6 take away 4, take away now half of the electrons, that pairs that are being bonded belong to the oxygen. So 2, 4, there's going to be 6 electrons belonging to oxygen for this oxygen atom that's double bonded. So that gives us a formal charge of 0. And this one is a formal charge of 0. Now for sulfur, sulfur has 6 valence shell electrons. So 1 of those electrons plus 1 of those, 2 of those, and 2 of those add up to 6. The formal charge of sulfur here is going to be 0. So this would be the best possible Lewis structure we could use to represent a sulfate ion of SO4 2-, because it reduces the formal charges to the lowest possible numbers required to make the overall charge -2, because after all, this was a sulfate ion we were drawing the Lewis structure for. Now note that adding a double bond decreases the formal charge of one of the atoms in the bond and increases the formal charge of the other. So for instance, one of the examples I previously showed you, you can see if sulfur is a +2, how can we make it less positive? We could transfer an electron pair from an adjacent oxygen. to it to make it less positive. And if we do it in two locations, we end up with the more correct answer for the Lewis structure. Again, these are all things I've mentioned before. The sum of all the formal charges has to add up to minus two. So the best structure for sulfate minus two is one where we have two single bonds and two double bonds. And here are all three trials. To apply that rule, in the first example, sulfur was minus two, oxygens were zero. In the second trial, sulfur was plus two, oxygen was minus one. And sulfur was zero in trial three, oxygens were minus one, and some were zero. So again, when we're deciding which is the best model, the lowest possible, twos typically are too high for formal charges. In this case, sulfur is zero, and we have two oxygens that are minus one. This is the best solution for that Lewis structure. So again, as I've said, you compare trial two and three. You can see when we moved an electron pair from one of the oxygens to the sulfur, in effect, moving it up here, we have made sulfur less positive and oxygen went less negative. So we went from a minus one to a zero because we moved that pair of electrons that belong totally to oxygen. Well, one of them is now going to be assigned to sulfur and only one will be retained by the oxygen. So I hope that makes sense to you. And we did the same thing over here. We can shift that from negative one to zero by shifting an electron pair to this location here, which I'm showing in this example. So there are those three examples. A final good check is to count the valence shell electrons in all your structures to see if they add up. Well, we said sulfur has six valence shell electrons, oxygen has six. So we have we have five atoms that each have six. So that's 30 electrons. One, two, three, four, five. Okay, we have six from sulfur. We have four oxygens, which is 24. So that should be 30 electrons. I apologize there. So now if you count them, there should be 30 electrons. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 18, 22, 24, 6, 28, 30. Okay, so we can now Okay. Now, one of the problems with this model is it shows two of the oxygen atoms differ from the other two. Whenever we actually look at experimental evidence, we find that in fact, in a sulfate ion that's been crystallized, we find the electron pairs are are all equal. We find the bond distances are all equal. The bond distances are somewhere between a single bond and a double bond. And in that case, it's more precise to simply say the electron pairs resonate around the sulfur and oxygens, and they're all being shared collectively. They resonate. So we're going to talk about that as a better model for understanding electrons, how electrons are being shared within groups of atoms, and how Lewis structures have their limitations, that sometimes reality defies our ability to explain it with a simple model. Therefore, we have to come up with another model to explain the observational evidence. And that model is one in resonance, which we're going to cover in a later lecture. So if we compare the formal charge and oxidation numbers in a substance like HCl, we can see in this case, chlorine has an oxidation number minus one, because we're assuming that the chlorine completely steals the electron pair, and hydrogen is going to be, in this case, it loses its electron, so it's going to be a plus one. Now, if we're doing formal charges, we're going to say chlorine has 7 valence shell electrons. And in this bookkeeping system, when we assign sharing of electrons equally, we can say chlorine's formal charge will be 0. So two different methods of bookkeeping for electrons to serve two different purposes, depending on the task at hand. If we're trying to name the compound, I'm going to use oxidation numbers. If we're trying to figure out Lewis structures, like the previous examples, then I'm going to use formal charges to see which Lewis structure is the best one. So your suggested homework after this lesson is to read Petrucci, those pages, and to go over examples in the textbook in chapter 10, and to try the problems in your textbook that are shown there.